Hello, and welcome to Couch Time. My name is Martin.
I'm Sterling.
And I'm Daniel.
And today we're talking about stuff. Woo! Stuff.
Okay.
This episode of Couch Time is brought to you by our Patreon backers. We want to thank each and every one of you for supporting us and supporting the channel and what we're doing. I want to start out by thanking Kelly Baker. Thanks, Kelly.
Thanks. Kelly. J. Patrick Walker. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Patrick. Stephen Dewey.
Stephen. Thank you, Stephen. Thank you so much. For those of you who are fans of the channel, Stephen is the creator of the 10 Candles role-playing game, the role-playing system. We played it here on the channel, and we had an amazing time. So thank you, Stephen, and go check out his game at Calvary Games. So, perfect.
Justin Briscoe. Thank you.
Thank you, Justin.
Thanks, Justin.
And lastly, Daniel Sheldon. Thank you, Daniel.
Thanks, Daniel.
So before we get into our episode of Couch Time, I guess we're already into it. So we're just going to do some channel updates, and we're going to start with miniature painting.
Okay, so for those of you that didn't see, I put out a video a little while ago. Right now, miniature painting is kind of on a little bit of a hiatus. I had an unexpected move pop up, and as such, I haven't found a suitable location to reset up my studio. Where I'm at right now, I don't quite have the space, but I'm hoping to be able to get in a situation where I can begin painting again and get it filmed and back on the channel.
Yeah, so thanks for being patient with us on waiting for that miniature painting content. I know a lot of you guys have had a lot of fun watching that. Two of you binge-watched it recently and left us comments, so thank you for leaving your comments. One thing I want to talk about real quick, too, is the Star Wars Force Awakens beginner game. We've been releasing that. We recently shot it, and I played and ran a sort of tutorial or beginner game completely, because for those of you who are familiar with our role-playing stuff on the channel, we've got the Legacy of Ash campaign, and then we wanted to go back and do something very very basic, very beginner box, tutorial-esque. So we went back and we did the Force Awakens beginner game, and I ran that. The entire thing's coming out. We divided each encounter from the beginner game into an episode. So there's going to be 8 episodes. There's a wrap-up where every one of the players who's never played Star Wars before is going to be talking about their experiences, how easy the system was to pick up. And these guys are people who have been playing D20 fantasy systems or improv-based systems, but they've never played the FFG Star Wars system. So we sat down and introduced them to that and showed how easy the system was to pick up, how easy it was to go from zero experience into interpreting dice pools and having fun like that. Because I know some of the viewers for Legacy of Ash have commented that, you know, how do you learn how to roll dice, or how do you learn to build the dice pool or interpret the results? So we do a lot more simplistic breakdowns in the Force Awakens beginner game. And we're about halfway through the series, and we're releasing every couple days. And then we did the wrap-up, like I said, and we have the bloopers already available on Patreon if you're having fun watching that, enjoying the humor as well.
And as far as Legacy of Ash goes, we are about halfway through episode 3 right now. We're off Corellia and still having a heck of a fun time doing jokes and being goofy and stuff, but there's definitely going to be a tonal shift within this episode where the story really starts to kick into gear, and I think you see a lot of growth coming from our characters here in the near future, so look forward to that.
Yeah, especially in the Legacy of Ash, we've had you know, we've had a little bit of story. We've probed at Vox and saw what his mysteries are, and we've explored characters a little bit, but for the most part, it's pretty much just been like Tony Cupcake and Kevin the Waiter, and a lot of craziness. And so the interesting thing about campaigns, and especially for those of you who played role-playing games, you probably know this very well, but when you get into a campaign, you kind of discover where the story is going together, and you discover the pacing and the feel of it. And honestly, a lot of campaigns, especially early on, have these weird growing pains or growth spurts to where you're starting out super fast or starting out super slow. I think in this case, how did we start out? Like, we didn't get to characterization for a little while, did we?
Well, starting out with a conflict like that really helps move things along. It helps unite the party because there's a sense of urgency. There's something you have to deal with.
Yeah, the conflict is the episode zero kind of overarching.
And so we didn't really start to have a lot of character development or even really having the characters show who they are until we got to Corellia, because honestly, there just wasn't time.
Yeah. Well, and
even then, it was like a couple hours into Corellia before I think any of us really started...
Talking to each other. No, and I think as a GM, you want to have that first episode really have a foundation for your campaign with the Death Star and Alderaan and stuff like that. We really wanted to create a situation where you knew what was at stake, where you felt the evil of the Empire. I remember working on that very first episode, writing down and frantically preparing for it, just thinking, like, what are some cool things that could happen? One of my favorite moments from just that even first hour is, like, when the water starts to lift out of the fountain right before, when the Death Star appears in orbit, because that just defies the physics, you know, and it makes you realize that, like, crazy shit is happening and that this is not normal. And then we get into it, and we get to Corellia, and Corellia is all over the damn place.
Corellia ended up going about, what'd you say, 4 times as long as we thought it would?
Probably way longer. So Corellia is 22 episodes, or 22 sessions, 22 hours of content, and I legitimately thought we would be done with Corellia in about 8 hours tops. And we constantly joke about how long we were supposed to be on Corellia versus...
About when we're finally going to get off Corellia.
The running joke of our campaign for a while was, maybe tonight we'll finally get off Corellia. And I think we even make those jokes in episode 3. I know that maybe in one of the outros coming up is Jenny mentions, well, maybe we'll just stay on Hope's Light for a week, because the first 3 hours of episode 3 are just the first night we get there.
You know, I think we only stayed on Corellia for a week.
Yeah, well... That's true, yeah. We spent, yeah. So it's that kind of slingshotting back and forth between the pacing and, for us, the silliness.
Yeah.
And we're definitely discovering the story. We're buckling down and finally getting to the story. So I know a lot of you guys have commented on how the humor is insatiable, or how the humor, you keep coming back for the humor. One of you mentioned that Mondays is now one of your favorite days of the week because of this. So, thank you for all your comments and feedback and stuff like that, because we get a kick out of reading that. We love to see that what we're doing as far as especially the campaign, how that's entertaining you guys and kind of celebrating the silliness with us. So,
man, all these comments we've been getting lately have been fantastic. We just recently in the last couple of weeks have had a huge uptick in mm-hmm. kind of community involvement, and God, we love it. We love just sitting down and reading through the comments and... kind of reliving some of these old things, because we've, you know, when you play so much and you don't have as much of an opportunity to rewind and go back through it, there are little things you tend to forget.
Or miss completely, yeah. And
like Daniel said, once we started releasing some videos a couple weeks ago, we started back up with that. We took the holidays off and kind of took a break and stuff, and once we started throwing videos back up on the channel... We saw a huge rise in comments and stuff, so just keep it up. We love interacting with you guys and reading what you wrote.
And we just got a bunch of new subscribers to the channel, so the channel's growing really fast, and it's always so surreal to kind of see, we release an episode and there's 100 views, and like for us, you know, we're just a bunch of nerds in a basement playing games, and so that's really crazy, and we're pretty honored to be able to entertain you on Mondays when you're slow at work.
Especially from like where we started this. I mean, you can go back and watch in our first couch time, we talk about it kind of exhaustively, but we just started this as a way for almost friends that have moved on to be able to come back to the table and see what we're doing, you know, to have that opportunity. And now we release a video and 1,700 people get an email about it.
Yeah. So we apologize, but also you're welcome, I guess. I don't know. But yeah, the things that we kind of want to talk to today, one thing that we've noticed lately is a lot of people have been asking us, or at least telling us, you know, that they like our style, the way we play, or that they're going to borrow some stuff from me as a GM, or that Remy has the best puns, or that Bruto should really turn around his feelings and let love into his heart.
It's not going to happen. That heart is way too scarred.
He's kind of a burned out husk at this point. We're just trying to make him smile.
It's what it takes to survive in that big, dangerous galaxy.
Yeah. So, but one of the things that we want to talk about is kind of changing habits at the table almost, or I don't know if it's habits so much, but like, for us, when you look at how we play, We don't have a lot of electronics out. We try and be in the moment as much as possible. We try and be at the table physically and mentally. I know for a lot of you who play online, you have to play through things like Google Hangouts or something like that. Your community might not be able to support stuff like that. But honestly, for me, a lot of the ways I've gotten so many friends to join me at the table is duping my friends into it. We don't have a big gaming community where we live, so honestly, friends that you might not think would ever want to play role-playing games have turned out to be some of my craziest and most fun role-players to play with. And so when we're talking about setting up at the table and buckling down and minimizing distractions, right, we take breaks about every hour just to step away from the table. We have to cycle recordings because we're doing this for the entertainment factor too for the channel, but a big portion of that is we didn't always used to do that and taking that hourly break, and I think that slowed down how much content we create or how much game we get through.
Well, it may have slowed it down. We used to run for probably, I'd say, 2.5 hours on a recorder, just a voice recorder, before we'd switch over and take a break and stretch legs, get drinks, food, that kind of stuff. And while we were running for that duration, we were always kind of phones at the table. If something came up, we just dealt with it there. One of the biggest things that can help make for a great kind of play experience is being able to get rid of those distractions. I mean, everybody knows that guy. That guy that's sitting at the table and he's got his phone out. He's always looking at it.
Half in, half out, yeah.
It's vibrating the table and shaking dice. And
Or he's just sitting on it. Chatting, and then it's his turn to roleplay, or it's his turn to kill a monster.
Oh, God forbid it's in the middle of a combat-heavy system, and suddenly it's their turn, and they have no idea what they're doing. And
Like, there are extenuating circumstances. We've played with players before who have kids, and
Emergencies
come up at times, but I think for the most part, it's just focusing about being at the table and living in this fantasy world, and kind of leaving the rest of the world behind as much as possible, escaping it.
For me too, like, we have access to all this technology. We could have laptops at the table, especially like for a GM, you have to have so many books available and so many notes and stuff like that. But honestly, for me, as much as the temptation is there, removing that from the possibility of distraction or just even that electronic at the table, even a laptop for the GM, can still really change it for me. And it makes me less focused on what my players are doing. And the second, as a GM, you start being less focused on what your players are doing, your story unravels, your game unravels, because you're not there in the moment. And
well, distractions can come in different fashions, too. I mean, we talk about phones and computers and stuff. Even having excess books on the table. I mean, there's plenty of rules. Every system's got a ton of rules. But even if you can clear them off and only kind of commit the rules to memory and just check them as references. But even music can be a big one. We play with music via Sirenscape, which is a fantastic tool. But if you don't have the right music in a situation, it can really just destroy your immersion. It can pull you right out of it. We often joke, because occasionally on a Sirenscape playset, there will be a distracting sound effect that shows up. Like ridiculous seagulls or a merchant that's just screaming his... screaming for whatever he happens to be selling in an unintelligible Peddling Sims language. Wares, and these sorts of things can just pull someone right out of what could be a great scene.
There's a lot of things that can lead you to distraction. Him going back to having those books on the table and just clutter, right? If you can minimize that clutter, especially with the books, we play very fast and loose with a lot of the rules. We all read the rule books. We all take the time to be educated players or game masters or just educated role players, right? But there can be a big difference between double-checking something and stopping the game to be right about a rule. And for us, it's more important to keep that energy going, to keep that momentum going, than to stop and be like, well, actually, I think this is the rule for our ridiculous space combat, you know? And
in all honesty, I'm our table's rule lawyer. That's, for whatever reason, that's a role I naturally stepped into. And the best advice I ever came across was that if a rule discussion takes longer than 20 seconds, agree on a solution now and check it later.
Yep.
Yeah.
Because if it goes longer than that, it's unnecessary.
And it's distracting, and it can destroy your momentum. So those are
the rules are there to like give you a guideline for role playing. But role playing is essentially improv. If you don't know it, you can make it up and compensate for it later.
If you're doing what's fun, keep doing what's fun.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
I mean,
absolutely.
Recently, we just did a ridiculous creation, a ridiculous set of rules that we just pulled out of nowhere as a means of having some kind of justification for a hilarious thing that we did at the table.
I mean, we can talk about
the
episodes
beach volleyball.
We played beach volleyball for about 45 minutes in an episode recently.
Yeah.
There are no rules Legacy for beach 3. Volleyball 2. In Star Wars.
there's important things to know because there aren't rules, and instead of me just making it coordination check after coordination check, we started to do this weird hybrid thing, and even Sterling commented how the rules changed as we played. And that can be frustrating for players. That absolutely can. But at the same time, if you guys aren't trying to make beach volleyball, if you guys are constantly trying to make beach volleyball perfect, then you're not playing beach volleyball in Star Wars.
If you're trying to make beach volleyball in Star Wars and you have a dedicated rule sheet all written out, you're doing something wrong.
You're not. Oh, yeah. You're not playing beach volleyball in Star Wars anymore. You're rolling dice.
I think. Crap! I forgot what I was going to say. Never mind. Oh, role playing games aren't about winning. If you're,
you
win by having fun. Like that's the whole point. Telling a good story is,
and
just
that's
having fun.
That's difficult for people.
Mm-hmm.
So I'm older than these guys, and there's a lot of people who play that are older than me. And unfortunately, the genre of role-playing games grew up with a lot of the players. And, you know, you look at the modern scene, and there's everything across the spectrum. But when you go back and look at the really early stuff, there's really strict rules for everything.
Yeah.
It's crunch-heavy systems all over the place. There's a couple light things, and there's a couple things that, you know, just have baselines. But some of these players in your group, players at home, grew up playing with rigid systems that have to be this way, and they grew up playing that and played it for decades. And so for us, throwing the rule book out to make a beach volleyball game is as fun as prying into some mechanics dense thing and doing it perfectly. Mm-hmm. But instead of double checking all this stuff, we just go with the flow.
And you know, there's hope. If you're stuck in one of those rules crunchy game systems right now, if that's what your table is, you know, I started playing with Martin ages ago in a 4th edition campaign. And if anybody has ever played 4th edition D&D, you know that it is crunch central. It's almost as bad as, I would say, as 3.5, except it's a different style of crunch.
It's worse than 3.5 for sure.
And
4th edition is good and so bad.
We went from that, from a really combat-heavy group, to what we have now. Mm-hmm. And you know, what we play when we get the chance to play off camera is no different than what you guys see.
Yeah. I mean, it's, I don't know, like,
it's probably a little more silly, probably a little less focused,
yeah.
But
it's definitely can be more inappropriate, obviously.
Yeah.
on the medium, we don't want to, like, violate any terms of service or anything.
We don't want to get our channel flagged.
But it can get quite ridiculous. But the big thing is, too, is that we came from somewhere, and our table is constantly evolving. My GM style is constantly evolving. Their play styles are constantly evolving. And that's what's so much fun about this, right? Taking something that you know and trying to get better at it. Taking role-playing and trying to get better at it. Our last campaign before this was a Dungeons & Dragons 5th edition campaign. And we were fortunate enough, unlike 90, you know, a majority of campaigns out there, 90% or so, fail. Like, those campaigns fail. And we were lucky enough to run a year-long, 110, 120-hour campaign on voice recorder and see a complete story arc, an entire sort of TV series come to fruition. Like, when you watch television and a show craps out in the third season and just cancels, that's a campaign for most people. But for us, we got to have that great story arc that went the distance. And
we took this story, in far as like a mechanical term, from like NPC level 0 to level 16. through the D&D 5th Ed system.
Yeah, there might have been a little bit fudging with the experience
points. There
were
a couple that were jumps, but...
Yeah, but we really put our, you know, we really put it to the grindstone and just kind of played a campaign. And it was dark. It was horribly depressing at times.
Oh, yes.
But we shed tears at the table.
But the thing was, is that role-playing games give you as a player and you as a GM and you as a group of friends at a table such a powerful experience if you let it. If you clear the distractions, if you forget about the rules sometimes, and you sit down and you play a game, you sit down and you tell a story with your friends, you cooperatively tell a story with your friends where the game master isn't trying to win and the players aren't trying to break their characters so they can be the most powerful thing ever, a good GM will be a fan of the heroes. They will make your players feel powerful, feel great, but that greatness has to have the lows to feel the highs. Mm-hmm. And that's what that campaign was. You kick them while they're down, and then you pick them back up, and you show them how much more powerful they can be now that they've learned from that, now that they've learned from that failure, that defeat. And so we went through this very dark, very serious, Tyranny of Dragons inspired homebrew campaign, and we took it, and really, that was the thing that led to Nerds and Stuff, honestly, in my opinion. Mm-hmm. We started recording that, and about halfway through the campaign, we had such a powerful session that it was kind of a point of no return for our role-playing style. And since then, we've been continuously getting better at what we do as cooperative storytellers.
Yeah, it's that... You know, your players shouldn't always win for the DMs. And the players shouldn't always lose. But there are times when you're literally going to throw your players into a situation they have no way to possibly win. And when that happens, as long as you can reward them and build that trust with your players, you can tell an incredible story. I mean, the conclusion of that campaign put us in such a situation that it was unfathomable that we could possibly win.
Yeah.
But the path of getting there made for such an incredible emotional experience that it was just... It's a story I would love to see again.
Yeah. What's funny is, we were talking about this recently, I know a lot of you guys are talking about how good Legacy of Ash is, and especially some of you were mentioning how you really like the story. We're just getting started on that story. Mm-hmm. And this campaign story, we didn't have the shtick. There wasn't the funny growing spurt and stuff like that. So that was just from the first hour, super crazy. And that's one of the reasons why that's our very first Patreon goal, is to get this kind of podcast stuff running. Because we have this entire campaign on audio recorder. Now, granted, it wasn't recorded for an audience. It was more recorded for a couple nerds in a basement playing games to remember this campaign forever. Mm. But we have it. And it's pretty boss hog. And so that's why we're trying to build this up and make it sustainable so we can start releasing that kind of stuff and share with you guys as much as possible. You know, we're constantly talking about what campaigns we could potentially run aside from Legacy of Ash and what kind of systems we want to get into, what systems complement our role-playing style, what systems are relevant, what systems are we never going to be able to break into the market and introduce new people to our channel. So we're constantly talking about this, not only as a business, but as friends who love playing together, you know?
Well, and we love our humor. You know, the stories that we tell, we love to have laced with these jokes and these terrible puns and things. And they're great. You know, they're fun to listen to. But when we really shine, it's when we hit the drama. When we tell a serious story, when we get down and dirty and gritty, that's when we really tell the memorable tales.
I think I was talking with one of our commenters back and forth a little bit, and I was talking about how the shtick that we do is funny, and you guys can fall in love with our humor. We're certainly in love with our own humor. But when we hit the point where we start telling a story worth telling, that's where we take a lot of pride in what we do. If you say a lot of stuff, right? We've been talking a long time for couch time right now, but if we just say a lot of stuff and none of it makes a difference, then you're just talking. But if you give advice or tell a story or do something or say something that's worth saying, then you can inspire someone. You can change someone's outlook. You can you can actually do something with action or thought or words that wasn't done before. You can change someone's life for the better, or you can make their table a little bit more fun to play at, or something like that.
RPGs are kind of an interesting thing. You know, people have a lot of masks that they wear. They show different faces depending on where they're at. But if you play long enough with someone at an RPG table, through enough campaigns where everybody's tried to build a serious character for themselves, you really end up learning a lot about who your friends really are. In a way that I have never encountered another medium to be able to do so.
Not only that, I mean, you tell amazing stories. The entire idea of couch time for us was sitting on a couch, and 90% of the time we just sit here and talk about... We'd pretty much be on member berries just talking about how good it was back in the day when we had campaigns, member, you know? Member Forthead? I member. Something like that, I think. But, yeah, I mean... We've talked a lot about role-playing games and stuff like that. I guess before we go, a couple things that we want to touch on is keep the comments coming. Especially, we'll be very interested to see the second half and beyond of Episode 3 of Legacy of Ash. Especially for those of you who discovered the channel recently, binge-watched the whole series, you crazy people, and just kind of got caught up and got excited about what we're doing. We have built something... And it's going to change. But that's what role-playing games are. That's what our story is. And we're going to hit some crazy stuff coming up. And we're really interested to see what you guys think. Because we can't stop talking about it. Off camera and behind the scenes and stuff like that. And I don't know. We're just really interested to see what you guys think. Because you guys... We leave a chair empty, missing, at the end of the table. That's where we put the camera. You watch other role-playing channels, especially local tables, right? We're not talking about the online screens everywhere. We're talking about at a table, and we have an empty space where the camera sits.
And that was my spot. I gave you guys
that was
spot.
His spot. He won't shut up about it still. We've been doing this
for
8 months.
Spot for a long
we've been
time.
Doing this for, we've been doing the channel for 8 months, so he hasn't sat there for at least 8 months. So I duped Daniel, my most veteran role player, out of his favorite chair, so you guys could sit at the table with us. So you guys could join in on our campaigns and experience the story. Yeah, sure, you don't get to roll dice, but, you know, there's some sessions where we don't get to roll dice, too.
We'll roll them for you. We've got this.
Yeah, yeah. And we'll make the awkward jokes that you guys can't, so. I don't know, anything else before we go?
The only other thing I have to say is, yeah, just keep commenting. Leave your role-playing success stories in the comments and stuff. Just, we love talking with you guys and interacting with you. We've all got Twitters that we try and be active on, and if people engage us on there, I guarantee you we'll engage back. So
for sure.
And you know what? Tell us about your favorite campaign. The one that you always go back to when you think fondly on RPGs. Let us know in the comments. Let's talk about it.
Yeah, probably don't do that on Twitter. It'd just be a pain in the ass, I bet.
140 characters at a time.
If you could talk about your favorite campaign in 140 characters, I feel so sorry for you. Like, I'm so sorry for you. And last thing, we have to do this. If you can support us, please do so on Patreon. Your support not only means the world to us, because it reinforces that we're not just a bunch of idiots, but mostly it allows us to grow the channel and reach new audiences and continue to do what we're doing and continue to expand upon it, right? We're talking about more campaigns. We're talking about branching out into other stuff, reaching audiences in different mediums, and it's with your support and only through your support can we get there. So thank you very much. We're going to go play some games and have a wonderful night.
That was a hell of a take.
That was pretty good.
That was
pretty good.
Damn good.
That's what couch time should be. All right.
I got a phone call like as we were talking.
I know.
Talking
in fact,
about,
I almost threw
like,
under the bus when we were talking about distractions at the table.
It wasn't vibrating. I just saw
that's
the light
so
come
funny.
On.
I saw
like,
it too,
oh.
And I was gonna be like, "This guy's phone is going off right now." Yeah, that is funny. Perfect. Now let's hope that recorded.
No.